It seems intuitive that a more sensitive COVID test is better than a less sensitive one. And yet, you may also have seen news stories suggesting that some COVID tests are too sensitive, or that cheaper, faster, and even less sensitive tests might be better. But why would they be better? And better for what? According to public health experts at Harvard and Brown University, in the fall of 2020, the US needed to do 8 times more testing to successfully suppress COVID-19, India needed to do 4 times more testing, Brazil needed to do 66 times more testing, Bolivia needed to do 140 times more testing, and Mexico needed to do over 400 times more testing. The idea behind saying COVID tests are too expensive and too sensitive is that part of what's kept countries from doing enough testing is the kind of tests being used. The current gold standard for COVID testing is a nasal swab PCR test. This test is highly sensitive, which means it's able to detect the presence of the virus even at very low levels of viral load. That's great for a doctor who wants to know whether their patient was infected with COVID-19, but if you're screening an entire community for COVID outbreaks, then PCR tests have a few downsides. First, PCR tests are expensive. To avoid breaking the bank, many places are focusing on testing only people who already have COVID symptoms or who were recently exposed to someone with COVID. That's the case where I live. Using only expensive tests means that we don't test, and therefore don't catch, most people who are contagious without showing symptoms. And we know that a significant proportion of COVID transmission comes from these asymptomatic people. Second, PCR tests take time, usually a couple of days for results to come back from the lab. And here's what the typical viral load in an infected person looks like over time. They're most infectious around the peak, and their infectiousness declines afterwards. So if test results take a few days to come back, chances are you miss the peak, which means missing the window of time during which the person is most likely to infect other people. Essentially, although PCR is very sensitive, it's also expensive and slow. So while it's great for diagnosis, it may not be the best test for screening a community. And the cheaper, faster testing alternatives are, no surprise, not as sensitive as PCR. But, and this is a subtle point and maybe wouldn't matter if PCR were cheap and fast, but when it comes to screening a community, PCR's high sensitivity could itself be a downside. PCR tests can detect very low viral loads, which is great if you happen to test somebody very early on in an infection, or very late and you want to confirm whether they were infected. But this sensitivity also means that a person can test positive for the infection when they're basically no longer infectious. And in fact, PCR is so sensitive that it can detect viral fragments and give a positive result even when there are no viable viruses left. So it's likely that by using PCR tests, we're quarantining and contact tracing some people when we don't need to. It's not that the PCR test is a bad test. In fact, it's a great test for what it's designed to do, which is to accurately and reliably detect even very low viral loads. It's just that it's more expensive, slower, and perhaps even more sensitive than would be ideal for screening a community. A less sensitive test could catch just as many highly infectious people as PCR, but it would miss people who are post-infectious, which you could argue is a good thing for screening purposes, since those people are no longer a significant threat. The downside is that you'd also miss people who are pre-infectious, which is undoubtedly a bad thing. But the math works out that if you have a test that's just a little bit less sensitive than PCR, but you use it a lot more frequently, you're actually more likely to detect an infection compared to infrequent PCR testing, so you can identify more infections overall. All of this suggests that if you're trying to screen a community for COVID outbreaks, you can get more testing for your dollar with rapid testing than PCR testing. That is, you can identify more infectious people more quickly for less money, as long as the rapid tests are only slightly less sensitive than PCR tests, but a lot cheaper. Rapid testing is not a replacement for PCR testing in a clinical setting, nor is it a replacement for masks, physical distancing, hand washing, and so on. And if PCR testing cost a tenth of what it does and took a tenth the time, we probably wouldn't be having this discussion. But if we're going to test widely and frequently enough to suppress COVID, then we can get more for our money with tests that are cheaper, faster, and perhaps counterintuitively, a little bit less sensitive. Okay, so that's the argument for rapid testing, and here are the caveats. No medical tests are perfect, and a negative test result isn't a foolproof guarantee of not being infected. Because rapid tests are less sensitive than PCR tests, this makes it more likely that infected people will slip through the cracks of a test. So as long as COVID is a problem, it's important to still take precautions like wearing a mask and social distancing, even if you test negative. And for people who are likely exposed to COVID-19, health authorities recommend that they quarantine for 14 days regardless of a negative test result, or that a negative rapid test result is verified by a PCR test. When a rapid test is just a little less sensitive than PCR, then the downsides of missing some infected people can be balanced out by the benefits of more widespread and frequent testing. But this only works up to a point. If the sensitivity of the rapid test is too low, the cost of missing many infections will outweigh the benefits of widespread testing. Luckily, the rapid tests for COVID are fairly close to PCR in their sensitivities. The graph we showed for viral load was based on measurements of patients' viral loads, and while all else being equal, a higher viral load tends to mean you're more infectious, there are a lot of other things that can also affect how infectious you are. We didn't really mention what happens when you aren't infected, but the test gives a positive result anyway. This isn't likely on any given test, but if you're testing a huge number of people frequently, then just by statistics alone, you can end up with a large number of false positive results. The rate of false positives is comparable between PCR tests and rapid tests, but it matters more with cheap rapid tests since the whole idea is to do way more tests. Finally, vaccines. So won't all of this be irrelevant once vaccines come out? Well, vaccines will certainly help, but unfortunately, testing will probably still play a major role in suppressing COVID. It's really a topic for another video. A very big thank you to Brilliant for sponsoring this episode of Minute Physics. With Minute Physics, I try to bring you deeper level explanations, while Brilliant engages you to solve fascinating, challenging problems yourself, guiding you to a deeper level understanding of science and mathematics. Like their course on knowledge and uncertainty. What's the most efficient way to zero in on the true criminal from a lineup of suspects? Or how worried should you be if you know a medical test is 90% sensitive and you get a positive result? To improve your knowledge and reduce your uncertainty, go to brilliant.org/minutephysics and sign up for free. The first 200 people will get 20% off the annual premium subscription with full access to all of Brilliant's courses, puzzles, and daily challenges. Again, thanks to Brilliant for their support.